One, two, one, two, y'all found one. All right, happy Sabbath, y'all. All right, it's great to see you guys here. I know you'd rather be doing this, but you're here to do it, but not really, because we've got a special guest that's here with us today. Can I call it P? P, where are you, buddy? P, a.k.a. also known as Mad Messenger. Welcome, my friend. I'm just going to grab you my mic just a moment. Check one, two, it's on. Awesome. Okay, P. Now, P is all the way from the beautiful island of Otara, which is just up the road from here. My hometown, too. I grew up in Otara, so it's nice to meet someone that's from there also. So, P, tell us, why Mad Messenger? Why have you decided to call yourself the Mad Messenger?
Well, really, it's just mad. It's not because I'm crazy or because I've got a few loose screws up my head. It's not because I'm a mad person. But mad is just a simple acronym which stands for music, art, drama, and dynamic speaking.
Amen to that. That's really awesome. Are you here with someone?
Yes, I'm here with my auntie. No, it's my wife. I'm here with my lovely wife, Caroline. She's over here. Mad Messenger is really about, it's really, not just me, but also my wife and also my kids as well.
That's really awesome. I hope you don't mind. Caroline, is it?
Caroline?
Yeah, can we call you up to the front too? So we're going to have a look at I think I'll get her to grab a mic too. Now, Caroline, tell me, how did you meet P?
We were in the same church for like 10 years and we didn't know each other until we were put together to teach a Sunday school class. And that's how I met him.
Awesome. Now, was it something that you expected or did it just take 10 years for it to unfold itself?
No.
No, totally unexpected.
Yeah, because I mean, I was really focused on God.
And P was focused on something else.
He was a distraction.
Oh, well, that's nice.
Oh, no, that's awesome. Now, so I understand you two, you travel around together when you can, and you share the word with, and your gift as well with other churches and those that are seeking to find Jesus in your ministry. Tell me, what was the most challenging place and what happened when you turned up to a church and it didn't quite turn out the way you expected? How did you overcome that?
Well, I'll tell you what, bro, there's been quite a few, and there's been a lot of times you rock up to a church, you go to a church, and you know, you're there late, you get there late, and it just, you know how you go with your kids, and you gotta go with your kids, and sometimes the kids kind of play up, and you're like, oh, you would just, you better listen, I can see the love of Jesus with you. So the kids sort of play up, and then my wife and I, we get into, you know, oh, it's your fault. So it's kind of, you know, we get to the church, and when you walk up to the church, the pastor or the minister goes, hey, how's it going? And you're like, oh, praise the Lord, good, man. Really, you just 5 minutes ago, you've just been at each other's neck and just been crazy. So many times when you get there, and just, man, and even the service, your expectations are not what you think, but God's plan is always good. God's plan is always the best. So I always go there with the mindset, okay, this is our plan, but God, whatever your plan is, then you just take over.
That's really awesome, P. You know, give him a hand for being here. We really appreciate that. And also, love your wife. Thanks, Kevin. You may now be seated. I'll hand it over to P. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Listen, thank you very much for having us this evening. And I just want to say a special thank you, just a special mention to Uppy. Thank you very much for the opportunity. Really appreciate it. Uppy's been Facebooking me, and we've just been kind of... Just kind of missing each other now and then, but thank you so much for the opportunity. A real privilege to be here this evening. I got to admit, I got to be honest that this is my wife and I's very first 7-day Adventist opportunity. You know, this is the first time we come out to a 7-day Adventist service. So God, just praise the Lord. It's a real privilege and honor to be here this evening. So hopefully it's not my last. You know, hopefully it all goes well. But I just really pray that. That God will bless us, that you will be blessed tonight, and that God will get all the preeminence, amen. So before we get into the message, and I've got to tell you what, man, you 7-day Adventists, man, you can sing. You can sing, man. I love that. I love the music, I love the praising and worship. through music and songs. And man, it's just beautiful. I've been to several churches there. You hear the AUGs and a bit of the Baptists here and there and the other denominations. But man, I got to tell you what, man, when you guys sing, just it brings back, you know, the nice harmonies, you know, the pure harmonies. And it's, I think that, to be honest, it's not the look at me how I'm singing, but it's just you're just really praising God. And I appreciate that. I really appreciate it. It really comes out with your heart. The whole team, including the musos. Well done. Let's give them a hand, eh? The one song in particular, I really enjoy that song, I Know Who I Am. Just that song, just knowing who you are in Christ is such a big thing. It's such a big deal. And I want to share my heart tonight. I really want to share my heart. And it kind of goes alongside with the theme that of I Know Who I Am. So before we get to the message, let's have a word of prayer. Let's give God honor and glory this evening. And just really let God open your hearts and your minds and your ears to what He has to share tonight. Amen. So let's pray. Father God, we come to you tonight, Lord. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your love, Lord. And Lord, Father, we pray that you get all the preeminence, God. And Lord God, you be glorified, that you be honored, Lord God. And Father, you be exalted tonight, Lord Jesus. Lord, you just move me to the side, Lord God. And Father, you just use me as your mouthpiece, Lord Father. So God, we praise your name. We thank you for each person that is here, each young person, Lord Father, and a mature person, everyone that is here, Lord God. So Lord, we thank you once again. We ask this in your precious and your holy name, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And we all say, Amen. Amen. So what I do right now, I'm going to start with a painting. So as I paint up, you know, I really would love for you to just if you know the song, if you want to just worship with me while I paint, then feel free to do so. Okay, so is that cool?
Amen.
Okay, so get the music cranking. We do this.
Every day.
Caroline! Come on, Caroline, push! Oh, come on, Caroline, push! Push, Caroline! Oh, I can see. Oh, yes, yes, yeah, yes! Woohoo! Yahoo! Choo! Woo! Oh, wow. Oh, Caroline. Oh, she looks just like you, Caroline. Oh, Caroline looks... Oh, she's beautiful. Oh, she's beautiful. She looks just like you. Oh, wow. Oh,
excuse me, Mr. Wilson.
Thank you, doctor. Thank you.
Mr. Wilson, congratulations. You have a beautiful, beautiful baby
thank
girl.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Wilson, we've just examined your daughter, and it seems, Mr. Wilson, I don't know how else to say this, but we've just examined your daughter, Mr. Wilson, and your daughter has a disability. She has a medical condition called Trisomy 21.
What's that?
Trisomy 21, Mr. Wilson, you may have heard of this before. It's a medical term for Down syndrome.
Down syndrome? Are you sure? Come on, check it out. Are you sure?
Mr. Wilson, I know this is really hard to hear. I don't know how else to share this with you, but we're pretty sure we've done what we need to do on our end. The consultant and the team are going to come in shortly. I don't know how else to share this with you, but your daughter has Down syndrome. I'm really sorry to have to break it to you this way. We should have picked it up in the earlier scans, and we didn't. The other thing, Mr. Wilson, is we haven't told your wife. I'm really, really sorry, Mr. Wilson.
Oh, come on. Oh, please, God, please. Oh, come on, God, come on, Lord. She's going to be a handicap. They're gonna mock her. They're gonna tease her. Will she be able to walk or talk? Oh God, what did I do? Why, God? Why?
That's your drama. Depicts how I felt. All the emotions that I felt when my daughter was born. Now you have to understand, I was a first time expecting dad. And just like that drum, I went crazy in the delivery room. I went ballistic, I was jumping for joy. Woohoo, yeah! Finally my baby girl was here. She arrived. My baby girl. I was going crazy. And I looked at the doctor's face and she had this look of concern on her face. But at the time I couldn't care less. I thought, wow, my baby girl is here. The doctor had to literally calm me down. Hey, Mr. Wilson, calm down. Calm down, Mr. Wilson. We need to take your daughter. We need to take you now. And they had my baby girl. And they had her. And they put her on my wife's chest for a few seconds. And they put her on this little hospital crate. And I had the privilege of strolling her out, taking her out. And as the doors opened, everyone was there. My family were there. My church family, friends were all there congratulating me. Wow, well done, Pete. She's beautiful. Yeah, wow. And as I was strolling my baby girl out, all I could see were these two beady eyes looking back at me. I thought, wow, thank you, God. Praise you. We took her to the neonatal unit. And we saw a specialist, a pediatrician who specializes with infants and babies and kids. The doctor had my baby girl. And he looked at her hands. He looked at her feet. He looked at her face. And as I stood outside waiting anxiously, the doctor comes out and says, hey, Mr. Wilson, your daughter has what we call trisomy 21. I'm thinking, what's trisomy? What is that? And he pauses and he looks down and he just looks up at me and he says, I'm sorry, Mr. Wilson. I'm sorry. Your daughter has Down syndrome. She has a disability. And I'll tell you, to be honest, all that joy, all that excitement went out the window just like that. I thought to myself, am I hearing things? God, are you sure? This can't be right. Come on, God. Am I hearing things? And I remember just turning around, walking through the corridor. Everyone was still there. Everyone was still congratulating me. Well done, Pete. She's beautiful. And I remember walking to the room where my wife was. And I remember her turning to look at me, and she asked me, how is she? How is our baby girl? And to be honest, I couldn't say anything. I just stood there, I just bawled, I just cried, I bawled my eyes out. And all I remember was just blurting out,
I'm sorry, Carolyn, our daughter has Down syndrome. She has a disability. And we cried and cried the whole night thinking, God? Why our daughter, God? Why, Lord? We cried and cried. And all those negative thoughts came to mind. She's going to be a handicapped. They're going to mock her. They're going to tease her. Will she be able to walk or talk? God? What sin did I do? God, why, Lord? Why? Well, this little girl is now 7 years old. And this little girl can talk, can read, can write, can do her maths better than her dad. And she can't forget it. She loves life. She loves to act. She loves to sing. She loves life. And it got me thinking, man, Lord, it shouldn't have been why me? And from the very beginning, it should have been from the very beginning, why not me, God? Why not me? Her name is Charlize Haziel Wilson. Haziel is a Hebrew name which means God strengthens. And I believe without a shadow of a doubt that God has strengthened this little girl and shown favor on this little girl's life. She's such a blessing to my wife and I, Charlize Haziel Wilson. And it already got me thinking about myself and about others around me. My baby girl, she loves being Charlize Haziel Wilson. She loves being who she is. She knows that she is different, but she loves it. She accepts who she is. She loves it. And it really poses a question with me. I have to look at myself and look at other people. And I have to ask myself this question. Do I have a disability? Do I have a disability? Now, I'm not talking about a physical or visible one that people can't see. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about an invisible disability that we hide from people, that the human eye cannot see, that we kind of put up behind, that people can't see, that we don't show people. And I have to ask myself this question. Do I have an invisible disability? Well, let me explain. Some of us in here tonight, if not all of us in here tonight, carry insecurities, carry baggage, carry regrets, carry hurts, things that have happened to you that you wish never ever happened to you. And because of all those things that you and I may be carrying, it disables us from being all that we could be for the kingdom of God and in this world. For example, some of us in here tonight don't even like who they are. Don't accept who they are. Oh, I wish I was a bit taller. Oh, I wish I was a bit thinner. Oh, I wish I had this person's gifts. Oh, I wish I had this person's talent. Oh, I wish I was clever. Oh, I'm just not good enough. I wish like this. I wish I looked like this. I wish I looked like her. I wish I had this person. Why did God give me the short end of the stick? Why, God? And they don't accept who they are. Who they are. But I want you tonight to imagine with me. Imagine with me how powerful and how empowered you and I could be for the kingdom of God if we would just accept who Amen. We are. I mean, truly accept who you are. Even with all your weird, wacky, strange, freaky, quirky, funny traits, truly accept who you are, but most importantly, accept who God created you to
Amen.
Be.
Amen.
Imagine how powerful that would be. How powerful you'd be for the kingdom, how powerful you'd be in this world. And my job is simple. My job is to simply give you four simple reasons as to why accepting who you are is such a powerful thing. And the first reason is this. Number one, accept who you are because you, my friends, you are unique. It's what makes you unique and separates you from everyone else in this whole room. Most importantly, everyone else in this whole entire world. There is no one quite like you. Each and every one of us in here was created different and unique. You know, they say in the world today there are 7 billion people in the world today. And out of those billions and billions and billions and billions and billions of people, no one is exactly the same. Each and every one of us is different and unique. Research also tells us that no one in this whole world has the same fingerprint, voice print, or footprint, all different and unique. You look up the definition for unique. This is what it says. Unique, unmatched, unparalleled, unequaled. Listen very carefully. One of a kind. And you, my friends, are one of a kind. There is no one, there will never, ever, ever, ever be anyone quite like you. Now, a few years ago, I was talking to these two boys, and I asked them this question. Why do you think that we're created different? Why do you think that God created us different? And the first boy really got him thinking, he got his hands in his pocket, thinking, oh, yeah. And stop. I know. We're all the same. The world will be boring, eh?
He said, yeah, the Lord be praised. Yeah, you're right, you're right. Another boy asked him the same question. This little boy sitting there, oh, why do you think that God created us different? And this little boy, you have to understand, this little boy is one of those boys that you love to hug, a big hug around the throat. You know, he's one of those naughty boys. One of those real naughty boys. Naughty kids. We challenge you and ask him the same question. Oh, what do you got him thinking? Oh, ooh, hands in his pocket, ooh, scratching his head. Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. Oh, I know, I know. If we're all the same. And if my mom came to pick me up from school, she might take the wrong kid home. True story, true story. True story, it's wrong. And I said, oh, yeah, 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 okay. And just like you had a bit of a laugh, I just had a bit of a chuckle and started laughing. Oh, yeah. And I remember his mom walking to pick him up from school. I thought to myself, poor woman. I'm sure your mom would love to take the wrong kid home. The reason why I take this story is because of this. Because even out of the mouths of babies, even out of the mouths of our children, they know that you and I created different. And the beauty of it is this, that God reveals himself right from the get-go, the very first book of the Bible, the very first verse, Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, God says what? In the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. Now God could have said, let there be light. Great, I'll just leave it as it is. But no, God reveals to you and I that he is the greatest architect, that he is the greatest creator, that he loves diversity and he loves variety. Each and every one of us in here was created different and unique. And the Bible puts it plain and simple in the book of Psalm 139, verses 13 to 15. It says what? Verse 13 says what? Even before you were born in your mother's womb, God was already forming and shaping you. Verse 14 says what? I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knows well. God tells you and I, praise him, because each and every one of you in here was created fearfully and wonderfully made. The verse 15 gets even better, says this. Even your frame wasn't hidden from God. Every intricate detail of who you would be, your skeletons, your flesh, your characteristics, your features, God was already forming and shaping you. You, my friends, without a shadow of a doubt, was created different and unique. You are one of a kind.
Amen.
Welcome to the planet. Welcome to existence. Everyone's here. Everyone's here. Everybody's watching you now. Everybody waits for you. Yeah. salvation is here.